Hallelujah. Good morning, Sunday morning, church. Will you please help me to stand to your feet this wonderful morning? You know, once again, you know, before we start service, the best thing to do is to greet your neighbors and tell them, welcome to church this morning. So help me to do that this morning. Turn around. Yes, you know, let's warm ourselves up. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, today I want to encourage you from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. It says, and you are living stones that God is building into His spiritual temple. What more, you are His holy priest. The Word of God tells us that we are living stones that God is building in this temple, in this house of God. So this morning, we want God to build ourselves up, build our lives up. Amen? If you are ready to praise and worship God, help me to give God a clap offering this morning. Amen.
Of God. Today, no matter what you're going through, let us praise Jesus, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen? Come on. Let's go. Try it.
praising Him. Let's keep rejoicing in Him. Tap your hands. We sing.
There's a light that shines with hope and grace fills the sky. With new mercy each day we're alive. Let your glory pour out, Jesus. There's a joy that overwhelms our souls, 'cause we know our God is in control. Overflow, let your favor pour out, Jesus. Let's sing it together. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Shines with hope and grace fills the sky. With new mercy each day we're alive. Let your glory pour out, Jesus. Oh, there's a joy.
Yesterday, 'cause today there's a new thing happening. Leave behind what happened yesterday, 'cause today there's a good thing happening. Leave behind what happened yesterday. Church, do you believe it? Leave behind what happened yesterday, 'cause today there's a good thing.
Jesus, this morning we rejoice in your presence. We sing of your name, for you are our Savior, you are our shield, our joy and delight. So this morning, church, continue to lift your voices and sing songs of praises to his name. Hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Just try singing now. I raise a hallelujah. disciples asked, "Why can't we cast it out?" And Jesus replied, "Most assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Be moved from here to there,' and it will be moved. For nothing is impossible for you. For nothing is impossible for you if you just believe." That's right, church, this morning, let our faith begin to arise. Let us begin to speak forth the word of God. Let us begin to sing to Jesus. Let us begin to sing of His promises. Oh, sing, O barren, you who have not more, break forth the singing and shout aloud to the Lord. Oh, sing to the mountain of unbelief. Be removed in the name of Jesus. Sing to the mountain of every sickness and illnesses. Be removed in the name of Jesus. So come on, church, lift up your voices. Lift up your faith to Him. Oh, sing a little louder.
Sacrifice of praise. Amen. That's right, let's worship. The presence of God is in this place. That's right, hands lifted high. Oh, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Worship you, all my life I offer you, simple melodies of sacrifice, open hands and open heart, you're the only one I want, your presence is my treasure, my delight, God I live to worship you. My life I offer you, simple melodies of sacrifice,
Open hands and open heart. You're the only one I want. Your presence is my treasure, my delight. For I pray, Holy Spirit, for I pray, Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall down, let your glory fall down. One thing I ask, one thing I see, so much more than anything, to dwell within your house for all my days. Knowing you is everything, so I let go of lesser things. You alone are worthy of my praise. So stir in me a passion for your name.
Of Hebrews, it says that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Today, as we come before God, as we come before him and we seek him, God, today, you are our reward. Our reward is not material gains. It is you. You are our portion, our reward. Holy Spirit, you are our reward. We just want you. We want more of you in our lives, Holy Spirit. So that's why hands lifted high. Begin to receive your reward. Your reward is the Holy Spirit. Come rest on us, Holy Spirit. We want more of you, Holy Spirit. Yes, Lord. Our reward forevermore, Lord. Our portion. May I never lose the one of your presence. May I always stand in awe of who you are. Oh, the beauty and the gift of your friendship is unlike anything I've ever known. May I never lose the wonder. May I never
so far.
How many of us can sense the presence of the Holy Spirit with us here in this place? Would you give the Lord a big hand clap? Let's welcome His presence here in this place. Hallelujah. You know what? Something wonderful always happens in the presence of the Holy Spirit. I know that our hearts, broken hearts will be mend, will be restored once again. The Lord is here to set every captive free, to open every blind eyes. There's nothing that's impossible for the Lord. As we're worshiping, I was reminded of Acts 4:31. It says, and when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. This morning, as we sing this song, it is like a prayer unto the Lord. Fall like rain on us, Holy Spirit. Fall like rain on us. Have your way in us. And the place where we are assembled together will be shaken. And the Lord will fill us with boldness, fearless boldness and confidence. Every mountain in your way can be removed in the mighty name of Jesus. Sickness can be healed. Miracles can happen in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. This morning, why not let's lift our hands to the Lord. Let's take a minute wherever you are, on site, online. I want you to pray in the Spirit and let this place where we are assembled be shaken by the power of the Holy Spirit. You pray, church. Sikala mahantiri ala gala bahari ala gala bahaya. Sikala la 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 bahantiri ala gala 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 bahari ala gala bahariya. Sukuri ala gala bahantiri ala gala 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 bahaya. Oh, let every heart be on fire. Every broken heart be healed in Jesus' name. Every fear, every despair, go in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, in the name of Jesus, every sickness, every disease and infirmity, go. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Sikiri ala gala gala bahari ala gala 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 gala. Hallelujah.
Holy Spirit, fall like rain. Holy Spirit, have your way. Let your glory fall.
Our lives to you. Come, Holy Spirit, permeate every area of our lives, in our family, in our job, in our relationships at home. Fall like rain, Holy Spirit. For where the river of life flows, Lord, every dead area will come to life again. There's healing. There is power. There is deliverance. There is restoration in your presence, Holy Spirit. So we welcome you this morning. We welcome you in every area of our lives. And Lord, we vow to give you all the glory. Come, Holy Spirit, do what only you can do. We give you all our praise and our worship. We pray all this in the wonderful name of Jesus. And all God's people give a loud amen. Amen. City Harvest, won't you clap your hands? Won't you shout to God with a voice of triumph? Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. What a wonderful presence of God. And I know that we are in for a great time. So before you're seated, won't you turn around to a few people and tell them, I'm so glad to see you here in church this morning. Amen. Well, at City Harvest Church, we love to welcome all our new friends. So after the service, if you are new here in this place, you're here for the first time or second time, your friends brought you here, your family members invited you here, please don't be in a hurry to leave. We want to invite you to visit our VIP lounge at Hall 605. We have a free complimentary coffee prepared for you. We have greeters there to fellowship with you. We want to welcome you and connect you to this big spiritual family. So in our church, we love you. Thank you for coming. Won't you turn to someone and tell the person, welcome to City Harvest Church. Amen. Amen. Well, in 2 weeks' time, church, you know what? We are celebrating Easter from March 29th to the 31st. Now, we are excited to present a full-scale drama production titled The Trail of the Century. So this, we have not had a big production like this, so it's going to be exciting. And we want to take that opportunity to share the good news of Jesus Christ with our friends, our colleagues, family members, who have yet to know Jesus. Now, we want to believe God together with you that they will be deeply moved by the presence of God and they will respond by giving their hearts to Jesus. So this week, we want to begin praying for their salvation. So if you look on your seat, there is a prayer card that looks like this. So won't you just take out the prayer card? It's a beautiful prayer card, the trial of the century. Now, there is a pen also on your seat. So what we are going to do is that I want you to write down the names of your friends. Now, if you do not have one of these cards, just please kindly raise your hands. The ushers are here to serve you. All right? Now, I want you to take a moment to write down the names of the people whom you are believing God for, those whom you are praying for their salvation, whom you want to invite to join for this Easter. Now, they could be your parents, your grandparents, siblings, neighbors, colleagues, or friends. Now, I want you to just write their name down because we are going to pray for them. As a church, the next 2 weeks, we will be praying. Our intercessors, Pastor Eileen and the entire team, they'll be praying over them, name by name. We want to believe God that as we bring their names before the Lord will move their hearts. And God will give us a chance to invite them to come to church. So this Easter, when one household member is saved, the entire household can be saved. Amen? So we want to believe God that they will say yes to Jesus. They'll respond to the altar call during the Easter service. So please write down their names. And our intercessors, our church will be praying for them. Now, if you notice on the card, there's two portions. There's this personal copy section. Now, that is for you to keep. And as for the other section, the church copy, please drop it into the offering bucket later during the offering. So please write down the names on both sections so that you can be praying for them and the other copy for the church to pray for them. So when the offering bucket passes by, just drop it into the offering bucket. Amen. So let's prepare our hearts to collect God's tithes and offering this morning.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Bob. How many of you can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place? Amen. All right, this morning, I'd like to read to you from 2 Samuel chapter 24. Now, over here, there's a story of how King David made a census of his army. He wanted to know how big the army was because there was an enemy that was coming. But you know, he did it out of fear. He did it out of uncertainty. And he, even his commanders told him, David, why you want to do such a thing? Don't do it. The Lord will fight for us. But you know, David went against all sound counsel. He went ahead and he did a census. And as a result, after that, he felt his sin against the Lord. And because of that, the Lord has to chastise him. And the Lord chastised the nation of Israel because of what the king did. And there was a plague that went through the land. And in 3 days, 70,000 people died. Even more drastic than COVID, right? It's a plague. Now, the plague was coming to Jerusalem, but it stopped outside at this place of a threshing place of the man, of this man called Arunah. And David knew that the Lord was showing mercy. So he went there and he wanted to build an altar unto the Lord. So he told Arunah, Arunah, I'm going to buy this threshing piece of land and I'm going to build an altar to the Lord. Now, Arunah was so generous to David, but David said this to Arunah. Let's start reading from verse, I think it's 24. It says this, but the king said to Arunah, no, I've got to buy it from you for a good price. I'm not going to offer God, my God, sacrifices that are no sacrifice. Meaning, I will not give to God anything that will cost me nothing. I'm going to give. Now listen, it's not the amount, but it was the attitude David had. He knew that he had to offer to God something that's a sacrifice to him. And so he paid for it. Bible tells us 50 silver of shekels. Now, the Bible says, God was moved by the prayers and that was the end of the disaster. You know, all of us go through some kind of disaster in life. Maybe this morning, we are going through some kind of disaster. Financial disaster, emotional disaster, marriage disaster, friendship disaster, career disaster, health disaster. And even in our family, we have many family members, they are not saved yet. Where are they going? They are going into a Christless eternity. What is that? A disaster. But over here, David showed us a principle in the Bible that there has to be this idea of sacrifice and of giving. And on this very same place where David offered a sacrifice, thousands of years back, Isaac was offered up. And then thousands of years later, this was where Jesus Christ was going to be crucified. So David prophetically knew that this was the right thing to do. And so this morning, I want to encourage all of you that as we give to our offering, don't just think, oh, I'm just giving some money. Don't just do it out of duty. Know that as you sacrifice, listen, once again, I want to say, it's not the amount. We are sacrificing for something of eternal value. The healing, the deliverance, the salvation, the breakthrough that we're going to have in our lives. And as you begin to give, I want you to know that the Lord, the Bible says this, the Lord was moved by the prayers and that was the end of disaster. And everybody said, you know, this morning as you give, I want you to know there are various modes of giving. You can give by cash, credit card, or check written out to City Harvest Church. Or you may scan a QR code that's in front of you right now at the back of the chair in front of you. Or you could give by the offering envelope. So I want you to prepare your offering right now. And as you prepare your offering, I want to remind you once again, take out the name card that you wrote your friend's names on, right? It says church copy. And then I want you to put together with your offering. So We want to do a prophetic act this morning, okay? So everybody take out this card. They're supposed to put in the offering bucket. Take out, wave it at me, wave it. Yeah. Everybody. I know it's Sunday morning, some of you are not awake yet. So make sure you check the card, says church copy. All right? Okay, now, I want you to take out your mode of giving offering. Is it offering envelope? Or is it your phone by QR code? So I want you to put these two together like that. Put it like this together. Okay, if it's a phone, you put it on the phone like that together. Okay, all right, you got it? Everybody on that? Now, why is this important? Because in the book of Acts, it says this, that the giving and the prayers rose up as a memorial before the Lord. How many of you want your loved ones' names to rise up as a memorial before God? And that from today onwards, the Lord will remember your mother is not saved. Your father is not saved. Your friends are not saved. And every time when you pray, the Lord remembers. How many think that's quite good? It's a Bible principle. Amen. So shall we all stand to our feet? You know, yeah. Let's stand to our feet. So remember, church copy. Everybody read the church copy. Mode of giving. Either your handphone or your offering envelope. Lift it before the Lord. Let's lift it before the Lord. Close your eyes and visualize that a memorial is set in heaven. A memorial stone is set there with the names of your loved ones. That's right. In the presence of God. Full of the presence of God and of the Holy Spirit. Away from every kind of devil. That's right. Every kind of demonic influence. The peace, the righteousness, and the love of God is in that place. Now begin to bathe this prayer card with prayer right now. Release your prayer language. Sunday morning service, come on, Sunday morning service. You can pray louder than that. Come on, Sunday morning service. You can pray louder than that. We've got to let our voice fill this auditorium right now. Pray louder than my microphone. That's right, pray from your heart. Pour out your passion. Pour out your desire to the Lord. Pour out your eternal desire. That's right. Shakati Ambrahani Alakati and the Rabbi. Inomakonta Rabahana Rabahada Rabahada Rabahai. Memorial prayer. Memorial prayer before the Lord this morning. Sugariada Rabakata Rabahada Rabahai. Shakada Rabahariya Rabahariya Rabahada Rabada 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 Rabahai. Just a little bit more. Little bit more. Few more seconds. Shuguriyada rabahada rabahai. Shakatambahada rabahada rabahai. Father, we are believing you, O God, that we are mixing our giving with our prayers this morning. We are believing for our own personal breakthroughs, but Lord, more than that, we are believing for our family's breakthrough, for an eternal gift, O God, that is beyond price and beyond measure. So Lord, we pray for all our loved ones that are written here. From today onwards, you will, O Lord, remember them because of our prayer and our giving. So we give you praise, we give you thanks, we give you glory and honor. And everyone said Sunday morning service aloud. Amen. Amen. Okay, we cannot clap. You know, it's a bit hard to clap like that. So, ushers, you may serve the people. Now remember, drop your card in the offering and drop your offering envelope inside, but keep your handphone with you. Yes, we will not know how to return you the handphone. Otherwise, amen. Ushers, please. Thank you.
What a wonderful time of giving this morning. All right, so we have a few announcements for you today. First of all, we'd like you to know that GEMS is holding their Go Conference 2024. With the theme, In Jesus' Name. This is where people working with the special needs field come together to corporately intercede for their ministries and the special needs community. There will be a breakfast fellowship for the participants to connect with one another. So please extend this invitation to your friends in the special needs field. If you know that there are people like therapists, teachers, managers, or administrators, come and invite them, right? Invite them to have a time of refreshment in the presence of God. Registration will close on the 14th of April, so quickly sign up via the link on the CHC app announcement. And so we know that Easter is coming. We have a lot of opportunities for you to invite your family and friends. First of all, we're gonna Jams is having its Easter service on the 23rd and 24th of February. This is a service for people with special needs. They are celebrating Easter in Suntec and Jurong West. There will be games, performances, and the sharing of God's Word. So if you need more details, do pick up a flyer that's at our reception counter right after the service. Next, Dialect Service is also celebrating Easter. They're having their celebration on the 24th of March at Jurong West. They're having a specially prepared drama called 这人是谁? It is about man at the lowest point of his life and how he met Jesus and Jesus turned his life around. This is happening on 24th March, 2 p.m. at the Jurong West B4 Auditorium. Next, Harvest Kids is also having Easter service, right? Easter Surprise will be held in Suntec on the 29th and 30th of March. They're going to have lots of fun, lots of songs, and a blind box giveaway. So it's going to be a time of great celebration. Bring your children, bring your children's friend to come and listen to the good news. Not only do we want to give them a lot of gifts, but we also want to give them the best gift ever, and that is the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. So not to forget, right, many announcements today. All right, Easter services, all right, Easter service big day on the 29th to 31st of March. We hope that you're still excited. All right, Pastor Bob has shared with us about our drama that's going to happen. It's the trial of the century. All right, this is a much anticipated drama production. It's a fresh stage performance that's never done before in CHC. So our services are happening on a Friday, 4 p.m., Saturday, 2 p.m., and 5 p.m., as well as Sunday, 10 a.m. If you're bringing people who need the interpretation, we're having live interpretation for our Saturday, 5 p.m., and Sunday, 10 a.m. service. So with all the things that's going on, we definitely need to pray. So our last announcement today is to invite all of you for our pre-service Easter prayer meeting. Right, we're going to have our church-wide prayer meeting on the 23rd and 24th of March, Saturday 4 p.m. as well as Sunday 9 a.m. So guys, we hope to see you here in service, not at 10 a.m., but 9 a.m. Come and pray together with us here in this main hall. We want to believe that God will show up in His glory in all that we do. Right, so turn to your neighbor and say that, let's come for the prayer meeting. So that's all the announcement. Let's get ready for a great word of God. Pastor Zhuang.
Thank you, Pauline. What a wonderful announcement. Hallelujah. Praise God. Such a great joy and a privilege to be able to share the word of God with you this morning. And I was feeling a little thirsty this morning, so I asked them to prepare a lot of water for me. Now, last year, I started a sermon series on Psalm 23. We have covered about 4.5 verses in that passage. I shared with you 3 sermons. The first one is My Shepherd Leads Me. The second one is My Shepherd Protects Me. And the third one is My Shepherd in My Valley. Today, I'd like to continue the 4th sermon on Psalm 23. Now, let me read to you from verse 1. It says, The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths. For His name's sake, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For You are with me, Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely Your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now, in this psalm, from verse 1 to verse 4, David describes God as the good shepherd. But in verse 5 to verse 6, he changes the metaphor of God to from the good shepherd to the gracious host. Everybody say, gracious host. Now, look at verse 5. He says, You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now, I've already shared with you the metaphor of the table. So we want to go straight to the second part of the verse. It says, you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Father, we want to thank you that this morning we can come together to worship you and having the privilege to give to you as well. And right now, even as we listen to the word of the Lord, God, we pray that you will speak to us, change us, strengthen us, and draw us closer to you, Jesus. We just commit this time to you. In Jesus' name, we pray. And everybody say, amen and amen. Thank you so much. Now, David says, you anoint my head with oil. In the ancient Near East culture, pouring oil on the visiting guest is actually an expression of welcome. It is a way to tell the guest that you respect him, honor him, and you are so happy that he's coming to your place. So David is saying that God, as a host, welcomes him into the house. The word oil also speaks of joy. Everybody say joy. Now let's look at Psalm 45, verse 7. It says, therefore God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. So when oil is poured on a guest, on your head, you receive joy in your soul. Oil makes you happy. Oil refreshes. Oil has this cooling effect, especially when you're coming, you know, from the hot sun. You anoint my head with oil has this expression that fat oil is flowing down your head. In fact, the word oil, in Hebrew is the word dashen. Everybody say dashen. It means to make fat. So when someone is anointed with oil, he is loaded with joy so that he can bear whatever challenges that may come his way. Now, you must know that Psalm 23, the context of it is really the valley experience. So I have good news for you. The Lord gives gladness in the darkest hour. The Lord gives gladness in the darkest hour. Whatever challenges that you're going through right now, God wants to load you with joy. You might be surrounded by the enemies like David. You might be going through a desert experience. You might be having issues, problems in your personal life, your finances, your family, your career. But as we come before the banquet table of the Lord, God wants to anoint you with oil and load you with joy. Turn to your neighbor and say, God wants to anoint you with oil and load you with joy. Now, over here, when David says, you anoint me with oil, my head with oil, he's really saying God welcomes him into the house. And God is loading him with joy. And the joy of the Lord is our strength so that he can go through any challenges, you know, that the enemy is giving to him. Now, I want to jump straight into the second part of this verse, which is the main message today. And David says, my cup overflows. My cup overflows. And that is the title of my message today. All right, so now, the word cup in Hebrew is the word kos, which figuratively means a person's lot or a person's portion in life. When we say the word cup, we are referring to what is inside the cup, the content of the cup, rather than the cup itself. And sometimes it can be referring to something negative. I shared with you a sermon on the Garden of Gethsemane before, right? In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus cried out to the Father, Father, if it is possible, let this cup be passed from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but you as you will. So this cup that Jesus drank was really the suffering on the cross. When he was crucified, Jesus bore the punishment of our sins that is filled in this cup on our behalf. Jesus drank the cup of suffering so that we can be reconciled and make peace with God. I want you to look at Psalm 116 and verse 13. David says, I will lift up the cup of salvation and praise the Lord's name for saving me. So the cup of salvation is made available for us today because of what Jesus did on the cross. Jesus drank the cup of suffering so that we can lift up the cup of salvation. Let me say one more time. Jesus drank the cup of suffering so that we can lift up the cup of salvation. On the cross, Jesus, the righteous one, he cried out, I thirst, so that we, the sinful ones, can sing, my cup overflows. Because Jesus drank the cup of suffering, our cup can now overflow with good things. He was cursed so that we can be blessed. And everybody say, come on, if you love Jesus, give him a big, big hand. Amen. Now, this cup can also be referring to something positive. Psalm 23 is such an example. In a banqueting table, or in a banquet hall, at the banquet table, David says that the Lord filled his cup with good things, and his cup is overflowing. The word overflow in Hebrew is the word revaya. Say with me, revaya. Now, this implies superabundance. This is an expression of God's generosity as a host. So this is not the basic hospitality. It is an extravagant generosity. So the host pours water or wine into the guest cup until it overflows. Wow, finally overflowing. Amen. Now, let me show you from the screen to give you a better picture of it. Now, so David, when he says, my cup overflows, he was really saying that he is a recipient of the personal, ongoing, extravagant, generous blessings of God. There was no shortage in the cup. David is saying that he's never thirsty because the cup is always full, it's overflowing. There's always abundance at the table of the Lord. He didn't just have enough, he has more than enough. My cup overflows. Hallelujah. Now, some people may ask me, Pastor, does it mean that Christians will not experience suffering and poverty? Is this the wealth and health theology? Does it mean that David was a man who had an easy life? My answer is no, 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 and no. In City Harvest, we don't subscribe to the prosperity gospel. If you know the Old Testament, you will know that David was a man who went through challenges after challenges almost in every season of his life. When he was a young boy, he was a neglected shepherd boy in his father's house. When he was working in a palace, he was hated by Saul. And then he became a fugitive when Saul tried to kill him many times. And in his exile, he had to hide in caves and pretend to be mad. David was a wartime king who faced one enemy after another. He was weak and ashamed when he committed adultery and murder. And even in his own household, his rebellious children broke his heart. And when he was much older, his own son, Absalom, tried to usurp his power. And even on his deathbed, even though David rejoiced at the covenant of God, but yet he couldn't help but to feel that his whole family didn't walk in full alignment with God. You know, therefore, I want you to know, Psalm 23, it is not the boasting of a spoiled youth. This is not the testimony of a trouble-free life. This is not a memoir of a peacetime king. This is definitely not an exclamation of someone who had an easy life with comfortable situation. But yet, in spite of all this, in spite of all the difficulties and the challenge, David sings, my soul or my cup overflows. My cup overflows. Why is that so? Why is that so? I believe David, the reason why he could sing, my cup overflows, is because David wasn't looking at the natural circumstances or the natural blessings as the source of his satisfaction in life. He was looking to the Lord as the source of his blessing. See, some people's cup will never overflow because they're always looking for fulfillment in the material blessings. They're always looking at the natural circumstances. But you know something? Material blessings, natural circumstances, they are not the right source. Some people try to find fulfillment or satisfaction in wealth. You know, everyone says, oh, if I can have a little bit more, I will have enough. Oh, if I can earn $1,000 more every month, oh, then I will have enough. And the problem is, when they do earn $1,000 more a month, they're so busy trying to upgrade and earn the next $1,000 more money. Some people say, oh, if only I can earn $1 million, hallelujah, I will spend more time with my family. I will go to church more regularly. Pastor Bobby, I will give to the UPG work. But when they do earn $1 million, they're so busy right now trying to earn the next million. City Harvest, money doesn't satisfy people. Now, some people try to find satisfaction with possessions, but soon they will realize that possessions never satisfy. I mean, in Singapore, the car prices, how many of you love cars? The car prices are sky high, right? Very expensive. The COE is so high. But praise God, seems like you are looking the chart, the trend. COE prices seems to be tapering down. Finally, you save up enough money. You went to your favorite brand, Mazda. You went to the showroom. All right, you chose your favorite SUV, Mazda. Paid the deposit. You drove the car out of the showroom. You love the car so much. You polish the car 3 hours a day. Oh, you love it so much. You drove the car to the office. And during lunchtime, you ask your colleague, hey, why don't we go for lunch together? I drove to work today. I can drive you. You know, the colleague said, oh yeah, let's go for lunch. But, you know, I can drive myself because after lunch, I'm going to another place. So both of you walk to the car park together. And you realize that your colleague parked his car right beside your car. You took a good look at his car. He's driving a Maserati. Whoa! All of a sudden, your brand new car looks quite insignificant parking beside his car. All of a sudden, you don't feel so proud of your Mazda SUV. You know what? Possession never satisfies. Some people look for satisfaction in power, but power really doesn't satisfy people because there is always a higher power. There is always a higher position. Just when you are happy that you are promoted at your workplace. But a few months later, somebody new and fresh came to your company and your boss promoted that guy or that girl, that sweet little thing, to become your boss. I mean, you have more experience. Yeah, she looks better and she has a better education. And you felt that you are being sidelined. You are so upset, angry, unjustified, and you try to look for another company. And when you join the next company, the same thing happened again. Power doesn't satisfy. Some people try to fill their cups with pleasure, but it's always in vain because desires and passion will only grow stronger. I mean, how many of you like to go for a holiday? I love to go holiday. Now, last year, December, maybe, all right, you finally booked your ticket. All right, you chose Bali, all right? So you are so excited. You bought your new sunglasses, your swimming costume, and who is that, huh? So you were enjoying yourself at Bali. And then you scroll your phone, and you got shocked. You saw your colleague, your friend, he is in Paris. Looking so happy. Looking so happy with his family. Oh, I mean, you are in Bali, he is in Paris. 你在巴厘岛，他在巴黎. Sounds alike, but very different. And before I offend all my Indonesian friends, I want you to know that Singaporean, we love Bali. Amen. Bali is a beautiful destination to go to. But I'm sure most of you will agree that Paris is another level of holiday, right? All of a sudden, you are no longer excited about your Bali trip. You know, pleasure never satisfies. It is like an itch at the back. The more you try to scratch it, the more dissatisfied you become. Some people try to fill their cups with fame. You know, they want to grow their social media influence, their following. But they are so affected when their friends don't press or hit the like button on their Facebook or their IG. And some people can really get depressed because of that. I want you to know something. True satisfaction doesn't come from recognition. Because you can go viral in one moment, you can be canceled in another moment. You can be a hero one day, you can be a zero in another. David wasn't looking at all these worldly material things for satisfaction. Money didn't satisfy him. Power, prestige, pleasure, wealth. In the midst of all these challenges, David sings, "My cup overflows." To David, he looks to the Lord for his satisfaction. That means to say, my bank account may not look very good, but my cup overflows. I may be single, but my cup overflows. I may not have children, but my cup overflows. I may struggle with sickness, but my cup overflows. I may not be promoted in my work, but my cup overflows. I may not have a car or a house to my name, but my cup overflows. Why? Because if I have God filling my cup, I have everything that I need. If you believe that, give God a big hand. Amen. If I have God filling my cup, I have everything that I need. Because only God truly satisfies. So how do we have an overflowing cup? Just a few points, right? Number one, be thankful for what you need. Be thankful for what you need. Let's look at 2 Timothy together. All right, 2 Timothy. Look at chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 2. It says over here, but know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful and unholy. So Paul is trying to say that unthankfulness leads to unholiness. Now, it's easy to become unthankful, especially when we go through difficult times, when we are disappointed with things, with life, and we become unthankful. And unthankfulness leads to discontentment. Everybody say discontentment. Now, look at Romans 1, verse 21. For although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God nor gave thanks to Him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. So when the children of Israel were wandering in the wilderness, they totally forgot that God is the one who brought them out of slavery. I mean, they were once slaves, but now they are free. And God supernaturally provided them with fresh manna every day from heaven. Now, but after eating the same thing again and again and again. They became disgruntled. They were unhappy. They were upset, and they started complaining. See, when we experience the goodness of God and when we become unthankful, the Bible says that our minds become futile, our hearts become darkened. I mean, can you imagine God provided them with fresh manna every day without them working for it? But they are still dissatisfied. And as a result of their unthankfulness, the Bible says that they built a golden calf to worship. You know what, brothers and sisters? For the unthankful, what they have is never enough. What they have is never enough. They're always yearning for more, and they will never be satisfied. I like what Charles Spurgeon, you know, he said something about the unthankful, and that was really good. Now, he said this. He said, for the unthankful, the meals they had today is never good enough. The bed they sleep on will never be comfortable enough. Some people are impossible to please, and they will never be content. Even if they do go up to heaven, they will find fault with the beauty of Eden. They will propose to change the course of the rivers or relocate the trees. They will criticize the music of angels. They will find fault with the cherubim and grow tired of the white robe and the golden harp. The streets of gold will be too shiny for their eyes. Wow. For the discontent, the cups will never overflow. I like what the Message Bible says. You know, one day my wife, Pastor Audrey, just showed me this passage. I thought, wow. Look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 to verse 5. It says, you are blessed when you are at the end of the rope. With less of you, there is more of God and His rule. You are blessed when you feel you have lost what is most dear to you. Only then can you be embraced by the one most dear to you. Verse 5, you are blessed when you are content with just who you are. No more, no less. That's the moment you find yourself proud owners of everything that can't be bought. See the harvest, be thankful, because unthankfulness leads to envy. Everybody say envy. Some people's cup will never overflow because of envy. Now, they can be content with what they have. No problem with point one. But when they see someone else has more, Bali and Paris, right? When they see someone else has more, wow, they cannot take it. They cannot stand it. They cannot tahan. So when they see someone in a higher social position, they want to bring them to their level. Envy is a problem that afflicts both the poor and the rich. Take a man like King Saul. He is the king. He has everything that he wants and he needs. But when David killed Goliath, and the women of Israel started to proclaim the song, King Saul killed the thousands, but David killed the tens of thousands. When he heard that, oh, he was so angry, so jealous, so envious. City Harvest, if our situation is challenging, we should be happy when others are spared from our level of challenges. We should be happy when others are happy. We should be enriched by the riches of others. We should be happy when others are blessed. We should be glad that our friend is in Paris. Amen. We should be happy when others are doing well in life. And we don't have this thinking, what about me? This what about me syndrome is bad. It stops you from your cup overflowing. Envy is what stops our cups from overflowing. David says, my cup overflows. I'm content with what God has given to me. I'm not envious of others because God is the one who truly satisfies me. All right, so number one, be thankful for what you have. Number two, have faith for what you need. Have faith for what you need. Now, verse 5 says, David says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. My cup overflows. Now, what he was trying to say is this. I can have faith for what I need in life. I can have faith because God provides a table provision for me. I can have faith for what I need. Because unbelief prevents the cup from overflowing. Now, it's easy to look at disappointing situation. And we feel like, I don't feel blessed. I'm not very blessed. It is true that in life, there will be times we don't feel very blessed. How many of you ever felt this way before? I have plenty of times. But if we are not careful, we can experience this thing called spiritual identity amnesia. We forget that we are God's favorite child. We forget that we are the apple of His eye. We forget that God wants to meet our needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. The scripture says, if we being evil know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more God wants to give to us? Now, I know the context of that is the Holy Spirit, but it's the same principle because God is a good Father. Turn to your neighbor and say, God is a good Father. So God wants to provide for us. We can have faith for what we need. David went through challenge after challenge after challenge. But yet he says, my cup overflows. You know something? Unbelief sees an empty cup. Let me just drink this. Might as well, right? Unbelief sees an empty cup. Doubt fears that this cup might be stolen, broken, or lost. Or not doubt. Doubt debates whether this is half full or half empty. But worry fears that this cup might be lost or stolen. But faith sings of an overflowing cup. Faith sings of an overflowing cup. And an overflowing cup results in overflowing praise. An overflowing cup results in overflowing praise. Somebody needs to give God an overflowing praise today. Come on, let's give God a big hand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise you. We bless you. Oh, God, we can believe. We can have faith for what we need because you are a wonderful God, wonderful Father. Amen. I want you to look at Psalm 16 and verse 5. Is this helpful? Now, let's look at verse 5. He says, the Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my Lord. So what is David saying? The Lord is my cup. He's saying that my cup is connected to the Lord, my shepherd. Listen to this important truth. All right? You cannot separate the cup that overflows from the hand that pours. You cannot separate the cup that overflows from the hand that pours. Amen? The person who pours is also the same person who will ensure that your cup overflows. Our cups may break, but you know what? God has many cups in the cupboard. So if you know and trust the hand that pours, no matter what situation you're in, you can still sing, my cup overflows. When you are going through a difficult time, remember God is faithful. He doesn't stop pouring. Your cup runneth over. He will satisfy you. Have faith for what you need because unbelief prevents your cup from overflowing. Look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, above and beyond all that we ask and think, according to the power that works in us. Whatever you need in your life, you can come to the banquet table of God because He is the God of abundance. There is no shortage at the table of the Lord. You ask God for one blessing, but He gives you many blessings. You ask God for a job, but He gives you a career. You ask God to take away the pain in your body, but God heals you completely. You needed help to forgive, but God helps you to forgive and forget. You yearn for the Lord to use you, but He gave you a ministry fruitful and helping many people. You want your children to stop acting up, but God transformed them radically. I want you to look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Listen, all you need to do is to ask of Him. I want all of us to lift up our cups. Just imagine you have a cup on your hand. I want to declare to you that your cup is not greater than God's fountain. Your thirst is not greater than God's supply. Your need is not greater than God's provision. Your weakness is not greater than God's strength. And your hurt is not greater than God's comfort. And your sickness is not greater than God's healing. And your sin is not greater than God's grace. If you believe that, give Jesus praise. Hallelujah. Oh, God has endless supply. He has given us every spiritual blessings. And last of all, the last point, stay close to God's presence. How do we have an overflowing cup? Stay close to God's presence. I like this the most. As David was talking about the metaphor of the cup, there is something significant about significant in the Jewish culture of those days. All right, so listen, all right? So the way a host fills up the cup of a guest, the way a host fills up the cup of a guest is an indication of his or her hospitality. All right, so let me explain that to you. When your guests come to your house and when they sit at a table, out of your generous hospitality, right, you fill up the cup of the guests. Now, when your guest drinks up the water or the cup until it's empty, what do? If you want your guests to stay longer, you fill the cup again, right? Now, you can do that a couple of times, but there will come a time you stop filling the cup. Why? Because it's late. your wife is already in pajamas. All right, your children are all in bed. It's time for your guests to go home. So if you are a guest, if your host stops filling your cup, you take that as a hint, as an indication, it is time to pack up. Leave before they ask you to leave. Don't overstay your welcome. That was how the cup was being used in the past. Maybe even, you know, today also the same, right? But sometimes when the host enjoys the company, the fellowship of the guests so much, now instead of filling the cup till it's full, the host will pour until the water or the wine overflows, dripping down to the saucer or even the table. The host is telling the guests, I love you so much. I'm enjoying your company so much. I don't want you to leave. I like you more than the wine. I like you more than the water. You know, it doesn't matter if the water is wasted. I like you more than that. I'm going to keep pouring and pouring and pouring. I never want you to leave. You know something, City Harvest Church? God is saying to you, I love being in relationship with you so much. I'm going to pour and pour and pour and pour until you are drenched, soaking wet at the table, because I don't want you to ever leave. This is the kind of relationship that God has for us, the love that He has for us. If you love Jesus back, let's give Jesus a big hand. Hallelujah. Amen. His desire is to be in relationship with us. Don't go. Stay with me. Stay in this relationship at the table. My question for all of us this morning is this. If God is welcoming you, will you stay at the table? If God is welcoming you, will you stay at the table? We need to understand that God is, He is never leaving the table. There is nothing you and I can do that will cause God to move Himself out of this relationship with us. God loves you. He's staying at the table. Will you stay at the table with Him? We may have sinned. We may have disappointed God. We may have stopped praying and seeking Him, but God is staying at the table. We may have left the table, but God is still at the table, calling us to come back to Him. Come back to the table. Come back into relationship with me. Stay with me. Now, if you try to move your cup, you are going to miss out the outflow that leads to the overflow. If you try to move your cup, you will miss the outflow that leads to the overflow. Wow. God is welcoming you. Will you stay at the table? Let me ask you, will you stay at the table when you are going through a crisis? Will you stay at the table when you face temptation? Or will you allow this temptation to move you out of this relationship with God? Will you stay at the table when you're uncertain of the future? Maybe some of you are holding on to the edge of the table. You are looking out and wondering if the grass is greener on the other side. But God is still here at the table. He still wants to pour into your cup. What about this? Will you stay at the table when you are super successful? When life is good, you are at cloud nine, everything is going on well for you. You have everything that you need, but will you still stay at the table with the Lord? Or are you looking out for more exciting things outside of this relationship with God? God is welcoming you. Come back to the outflow that leads to the overflow. Amen. In conclusion, I've shared with you the second part of verse 5. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. God is saying to David that God welcomes him into the house. And God is loading him with joy. Maybe some of us, we are experiencing a desert. It's hot out there. It's difficult. You're surrounded by enemies. But God wants to load you with joy, so that you can go through whatever challenges you're going through. And David says, my cup overflows. How do we have an overflowing cup in our lives? Number one, be thankful for what you already have. Be thankful for your family. Be thankful for your wife. Be thankful for your children. Be thankful for your parents. Be thankful for the job. You know, I was just watching a Netflix show. You know, if you still feel the pain, that means you are still alive. Be thankful you are still alive, even if you are sick. We don't need to be envious of others. An unthankful cup never overflows. Number two, have faith for what you need. Unbelief stops an overflowing cup. Don't give up on God. Keep on praying. Keep on trusting. Don't lose faith in God. Don't lose sight of the promises that God has given to you. Have faith for what you need. And even though David knew that God is a God of abundance, God can and God will supply. But yet David looks to the Lord as a source of his life, as a source of his satisfaction. Essentially, he's saying things in life don't satisfy me. Power, possessions, fame, all these things doesn't satisfy him. Only God satisfies him. And last of all, stay close to God's presence. God is welcoming you. He's not moving away. He's still pouring and pouring and pouring. So don't remove the cup from the outflow that leads to the overflow. Why don't we all stand our feet together right now? Isaiah sends the presence of the Lord all over here in this place. Something is happening. Something powerful is happening in our lives right now. Hallelujah. Lift up your hands and just talk to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just worship Him together.
And I just want to be a place for you to dwell, a habitation here that holds you well. I'll be the sacrifice, a living offering, a temple consecrated for my King. So come and make your home inside of me. And oh, your presence is all that I want. Jesus, there's nothing worth more than you. You're the reward. You are the prize. Come and have in my home.
That's why I worship God. Oh God, your presence is all that I want, Lord.
All that I want, Jesus, there's nothing but more than you. You're the reward, you are the prize. Come and have in my whole life the one thing that I've been.
God is all over here this morning. Some of us here in this place, maybe you are really going through a very tough time right now. It's a desert. It's dry. You're going through challenges and challenges. Like David, you are surrounded by enemies, difficulties. This morning, there is an oil of joy. God provides gladness in the darkest hour. You are in a darkest hour right now, but something is happening right here, right now. The oil of joy is just flowing. Fat oil is loading you, filling your heart with that joy to go through whatever challenges you're going through right now. You are not alone. God is with you. And then he says, my cup overflows. This morning, something is happening. Hallelujah. Maybe some of us here in this place, you're coming to a place where you feel yourself being unthankful. Maybe you didn't even realize it until this morning. You have been feeling disgruntled. You are feeling unhappy. You get agitated easily. And sometimes you take things for granted. You have taken what God has given you for granted. Maybe some of us, we have taken for granted our family, our jobs. Sometimes we have this sense of entitlement. This morning, be thankful for what you have, because an unthankful cup never overflows. And perhaps some of us, we feel discouraged because we're praying and praying and praying. Things are not happening. You know something? God wants to remind you today that He is a good Father. He is a good Father. He wants to supply all that you need according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Don't lose faith. Don't stop believing. His supply is more than what you need. His healing is more than what you need in your body. God is here. Your cup can overflow with good things. Hallelujah. Or perhaps some of us, we're feeling discouraged because we tend to compare and we are looking at the right or the wrong things for satisfaction. You're looking for power, you're looking for possessions, fame, money, wealth. Something is happening in your heart right now. Your minds are opening and you realize God is all that you need. If God is filling your cup is overflowing because you have everything that you need. Only God satisfies. Today, God is reminding some of us, don't remove the cup from the outflow that leads to the overflow. Perhaps some of us, you know, we have removed ourselves from the table. Going through a crisis, you're walking away from God. Some of us are facing temptation, you're walking away from the table. Or perhaps some of you, you know, you used to be in church all the time, but maybe now you're busy with success. You're so busy right now, and that success is moving you away from that relationship with the Lord. Today, God is saying, come back to the table. I'm waiting for you. Just come back to me. Why don't we lift up our hands, just talk to God wherever you are right now. Oh, let's worship God. His presence is here right now. Some of you are tears flowing down, hot tears flowing down from our hearts. God knows what you're going through. Today, God is just filling your cup. Your cup is overflowing. That dry season is gonna be over because God is filling your cup. Just lift up your hands. Just allow God to pour into your cup, your life. Hallelujah. Let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, I pray for all my dear brothers and sisters right now. As they are lifting up their hands to you, they're lifting their cups to you. Lord, I pray that you will fill the cups with your presence, Lord. Fill the cup with your essence, Lord. Fill the cup, Lord, for who you are. Help them to be thankful always for what you have already given to them. That they will never take you for granted. Lord, that they will always be happy and satisfied with the Lord. They will not be looking at things in the world for satisfaction because fame, power, wealth, riches, pleasure, they can't satisfy us. Only God, you can satisfy us. And I pray for those who are in need right now. That's why if you have need, just lift up your hand, just pray, have faith. Have faith. Have faith because unbelief stops an overflowing cup. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray you remind them that they are your favorite child. You are able, you are willing to supply all their need according to your riches and glory. And our need will never be greater than your supply. Hallelujah. 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 So, Father, I lift all my brothers up into your hands. In Jesus' name. Just lift the hand one more time. Thank you, God. Oh, hallelujah. Just sing one more time.
And oh, your presence is all that I want. Jesus, there's nothing worth more than you. You're the reward. You are the prize. Come and have in my heart.
You know, before I end the service, I believe God is speaking to two groups of people here in this place. The first group of you are those who have never received Jesus Christ into your life. Maybe your friend invited you. I mean, it's a school holiday for the youth. Or maybe for some of you, your persistent friend just invited you and you are here. I want you to know that it is more than just your friend inviting you. God is really the one that has been drawing you to this morning service. You know, and God is speaking to you right now. This morning, you sense the love of God here in this place. You can't explain in words, but you felt a warmth of His love reaching out to you. You know something? God loves you. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son to us, so that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. You say, why perish? Because the Bible says, the wages of sin is death. Some of you ask, what is sin, Pastor? Every time you speak a lie, you sin against God. Every time you use a vulgar word, you sin against God. Every time you have lustful thoughts in your mind, you sin against God. Or you harbor hatred in your heart, you sin against God. And the penalty of sin is death. But God loves you. He does not want you to die. That is why more than 2,000 years ago, God sent His only Son, Jesus, into this world. And on the cross, Jesus drank of the cup of suffering. He was crucified on the cross for your sin and my sin, so that we don't have to die. All we need to do is to believe in Him and confess Him as the Lord of your life. The second group of people are those of you You know, maybe you used to be in church, used to be on fire for God, used to read the Bible, but today you are not regular in church anymore. Maybe some of you have stopped coming to church altogether. Some of you are watching us on the screen right now. God is reaching out to you. Don't backslide anymore. Slide back to God. Some of you used to be praying, but today you are no longer praying. Maybe some of us, sin has stopped you from coming to God. Maybe some of us, crisis has moved us away from the table. Maybe for some of us, busyness, success has moved you from that relationship with God. While all eyes are closed, all heads are bowed, nobody walking around, nobody speaking, nobody looking except God's eyes and my eyes. At the count of three, I want every sinner, every backslider, if you know God loves you, you want to say yes to Jesus. At the count of three, no one is looking around, I want you to shoot up your hands. When I see your hands, I'm going to pray for you. Are you ready? I'm going to count to three. Every sinner, every backslider, lift up your hands. Are you ready? One, two, three. Lift up your hands right now, wherever you are. Yes, I see your hand. Yes, I see your hand. Yes, I see your hand. All the way at the back. All the way at the back. Yes, I see your hand. Yes, I see your hand. Just put it down right in the front. Just put it down. Hallelujah. I'm going to do one more thing. I'm going to count to three again. At the count of three, I want all of you that have lifted up your hands. You know you need to come to God. Or maybe some of you didn't lift up your hands, but you know God is drawing you. You know God loves you. And you know that you need to come forward. At the count of three, you know, all the sinners, all the backsliders, if you have lifted up your hands or you know you need to lift up your hands, at the count of three, I want you to come to the front. You know what? You make one step towards God. God will make 10,000 steps towards you because He loves you. Are you ready? One, two, three, come forward right now. That's right, let's give them a big hand. Just come forward, I see your hands. Doesn't matter if you are a new person or doesn't matter if you have been a Christian for a long time, you know you need to come to God. Come to God right now. That's right, just come to God. Cell leaders, just help me. Amen. Many people are coming forward. Many people are lifting up their hands. Amen. Just come right now. Just come. I'm waiting for you. Oh,
your presence is on.
That's why I just come right now. Just come. Jesus loves you. Just come to Jesus right now. Hallelujah. Just come to Him right now. Many people got saved yesterday. Hallelujah. Just come right now. Just come. Backsliders, come back to Jesus.
Your presence.
New world Christian, come to Jesus.
All that I want, Jesus, there's nothing worth more than you. You're the reward. You are the prize.
Amen. Let's give all the new friends a big, big hand. You know something? Last night, there are so many people that came forward. You know, whether you're young, you're old, you're new, or what, doesn't matter. Today, God is here. All right, so why don't we do this? I want you to just, members, just turn to someone beside you. If the person looks like a new person, ask the person, can I come out with you? Do you need Jesus in your life? I can walk out together with you. All right, so can we do that right now? Just turn to your neighbor and ask them, hey, do you need Jesus? Do you need a relationship with God? Do you need to come back to Jesus? Just ask your neighbor. Everybody, just do that. We are practicing because Easter is coming. Many people are going to come to Jesus. And today is the moment. I gave my heart to Jesus when I was 13 years old. A few years have passed. I've never regretted that decision. All right, so, all right, more people are coming. Let's give them a big hand. Just clap, all right? People are coming. That's why, just come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. More people are coming. Come to Jesus. That's why, just come. Just come. Just come. More people are coming. Don't be the one that is left out. Today, you can have a relationship with Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm waiting for you. Young or old. Young or old. Come to Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? One more person coming forward. Let's give the brother a big hand. Wow. Okay. No worries. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Those of you that are in the front, wow. I'm so happy that you are here joining us in this spiritual family. You know, God is our Heavenly Father, and He sent His Son Jesus to die for us on the cross. By making this decision, you know, you are safe. Right? You are safe. God forgives us. Wash us with His blood. Why don't we just put our hands like this, all right? Everybody put your hands like this. Amen. I want you to pray after me. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Come, the whole church, pray together. Those of you that are watching us on the online right now, you can say the same prayer as well. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
This morning. I know I'm a sinner.
I know I'm a sinner.
A backslider. I have sinned against you. I've done wrong things. But I know that you sent your Son Jesus. To die for my sins. On the cross.
Right now.
I invite Jesus. To come into my life. To be my personal Savior. Wash me. Of all my sins. Forgive me. Of all my transgressions. In Jesus' name.
Heavenly Father.
Thank you for your love. Thank you, Jesus. For what you have done. On the cross.
Holy Spirit.
I welcome you into my life.
Help me.
In my walk with God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Just let me say a prayer for you. Father, I pray for all these dear brothers and sisters who came forward so courageously to have a relationship with God, to have a relationship with you. Lord, I just want to pray that you will help them, God, in everything that they need in their lives, in their health, in their career, in their relationship, their marriage, their studies. Lord, I pray that you will empower them, refresh them, anoint them, and help them in their walk with you. Meet all their needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people say, amen. Can we give all the new friends a big hand? Yesterday, I forgot to come down to shake a hand. Let me just come down. Come on, let's give them a big hand. That's why let's give all these friends a big hand. Ooh. Now this is what we're going to do. Those of you that are in front, I want you to take a look at this very good-looking gentleman here. All right, so just follow him and go to the back. We have a gift for you, and our counselors want to pray for you. So can we just give them a big hand as they walk right now? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You know something? We all need Jesus. And I'm excited that Easter is coming. Right, today is not an evangelistic meeting, but you know, so many people, they need God in their lives. And many people are really ready to receive Jesus. I want all of us to try our best. Starting from next week, everybody bring someone to church. Tell your neighbor, I say, you got to bring somebody to church. All right, bring somebody to church. Next week, Pastor Kong is going to pray for the sick as well. And then during Easter, we're going to see many, many people getting saved. Are you happy? Amen. Shall we sing a praise song? Whatever praise song. Hallelujah. Come on. Woo! Come on, let's give Naomi a big, big hand.
Yeah. soul. Come what will, come what may, I'll worship anyway. Oh, the devil can try it, try to quiet this song.
Well, praise God. Thank you so much for coming to church today. Have a good, wonderful afternoon and see you next week in church. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Resurrection, hallelujah, is life.